Kate. And this is Lynn Wayman. And we've put this tape program together to help you create a selling situation where cold calls become a fading memory. And you begin to use the incredible power of strategic networking and referral prospecting. By following these techniques, you will see immediate results in your selling activity. And all your calls to prospects will become warm calls. Some people are born without any guidance or training, they naturally latch on to effective strategies. They do what's necessary to build a network of reciprocal relationships, or as I like to call it, but most people are not born networkers. They have to learn the behaviors of networking. And they have to learn how to turn casual conversations into great connections. Regardless of how effective a networker you are now, you will walk away from this tape program with new ideas that you can put to use right away.
Prospecting for referrals is without a doubt the most effective and most underused method for generating great leads.
Come alive for you. second part will show you the power of referral prospecting to bring you this valuable information on networking. I will interview Lynn Wayman, one of this country's leading experts on building business contacts. Lynn is the co-author of two popular books on networking. Great Connections, Small Talk and Networking for Business People, and 52 Ways to Reconnect, Follow Up, and Stay in Touch when you don't have time to network. Articles by or about her have recently appeared in more than 60 magazines and newspapers across the country, and she delivers speeches, seminars, and workshops on this valuable topic. At the end of this section, I will give you information on how you can order Lynn's books. Lynn, networking is such a business buzzword. What is good business networking?
Well, Bill, I found the answer to this question in the most amazing place. I saw a show on the Disney Channel the other night that said it all. The show was about a tribe in New Guinea, and in this tribe, leadership is bestowed not on the person who has accumulated the most. Instead, leadership is given to the person who's given away the most. Now that is what networking is about. Attracting people by giving resources, information, attention, support, referrals. Now, of course, there are things that you'd like to get, things you want to find or learn or connect with. But do the giving. and the getting will take care of itself.
Many people think that networking is merely going to business and social events and trying to meet prospects. But to me, it's much broader than that. Use networking effectively because it helps to have a networking strategy.
It sure does, and I have a three-part answer here. First of all, I tried networking last Thursday. It doesn't work. The best strategy is to think long term. Networking is exchanging information, resources, and ideas in such a way that it builds the relationship. It's not just meeting a potential customer. It's building a long-term, mutually beneficial relationship. Another part of strategy is to think mind over mouth. Choose to have a good networking mindset. I am so amazed how many of us approach thoughts like, oh, I hate this small talk. I ought to be back at the office working. I can't think of anything to say. In my workshop, I say good networking means mind over mouth. As you go to a meeting, whether it's a backyard barbecue or a networking program your mind to say to you, I'm wondering who I'm gonna meet here today. I'm gonna learn 5 people's names. Or maybe say to yourself, I have lots of topics I'd like to explore with people here. So they'll think long term, think mind over mouth, and finally tap into your 6 million person network. Yes. Here's how it works. Take you, Phil. Do you think you know 50 people? Alright. Neighbors, relatives, past co-workers, teachers. Those 50 people know 50 people. You now know 2,500 people who are only friends of friends. And if each of them know 50 people. You now know 25,000 people. And if each of them know 50 people, you now access to over 6 million people who are only 3 or 4 people away from you. If you know what to ask for, and we'll talk about that a little bit later.
And that's a great way to look at it. Now in your book, you mentioned 4 stages of the network. What are they?
The first one is all too common, and yet I suggest it's one that you ought to avoid. It's called taking. It's the me. It's same when you first meet someone. Hi, I sell specialty advertising products. If you ever need anything, give me a call. Bye. Like kissing too soon on the first day, it's offensive, and it rarely leads to good relationships. The second stage of networking is called trading. This is a little more productive. It's like I own a tree cutting service and you need trees cut down. But you can have so much more, which leads to the third stage of networking as a process of teaching people about you and your business, and of course learning about them and their business. The fourth and highest stage of networking is trusting. The best networkers build trust by showing over the long their character and confidence. Where trust has been built, the referrals that you talk about, Bill, will flow.
Good networking is joining certain key organizations. How do you choose the right organization?
Choose some groups because of the resources, referrals, support you can get. Choose others because your clients are there. I was recently coaching a cartoonist who was trying to build his business, and I suggested to him that he join the National Speakers Association because many speakers need cartoons for their slides, for their brochures, but there are no other cartoonists there. What a ripe market for him. Choose organizations that have a good networking culture. Well, what's that? Well, when you go to the meetings, do people seem up able to meet each other? Are newcomers welcomed? And are there ways to become visible? Is the organization growing and thriving, or dying and depressing?
So how many organizations do you think a person should join in order to have a good network?
People should be active in about 6 different arenas. Now, before you say, oh, this is impossible, I barely have time to do my laundry, let me explain what I mean by 6 arenas. One arena is certainly your family. Do you, brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, really know what kinds of resources and information to send your way? A second arena might be a professional association of peers. For instance, the National Association of Professional Saleswomen. A third might be a group where potential customers gather, such as the Chamber of Commerce. A fourth is your health club or the choir you sing in. A fifth could be a volunteer group or your kids' soccer team or your alumni association.
So now that I've joined an organization, what do I do to make it worth my time?
Well, joining is not enough. Can even attend events and still not have a network. You've got to get visible to make it worth the time and money. So contribute your skills, be the person that gives out the name tags, make an announcement, write a newsletter article. And by the way, introduce yourself to the speaker and the officers. Tell them why you're there, what you're interested in. By the speaker. Now that's visibility.
No, Lynn, that's a really good point. I was delivering a seminar yesterday, and a gentleman came up to me before the program. Guess what? 3 or 4 times during the program, I mentioned him and referred to his situation and built it into my program. So, you're right, anytime there's a speaker your event, you should go up and talk to them ahead of time. You're right, you might be mentioned by that speaker. Okay. So we're joining organizations, and all of us have a limited time to spend in the networking phase of business development. How do we decide what will yield the best?
Bullseye with concentric circles. Imagine this. On the outside rim are acquaintances. These are people that bump into randomly. You hardly know their names. Not very useful in terms of building your network. The next circle in are what I call associates. Because you have joined groups that they belong to too. So every month you show up at the Chamber of Commerce meeting. And in that association, about your business. The next circle in are what I call actors. Actors are people that you have an active exchange with. Something's going on. other, you get to trust each other, you get to test out, are they gonna do what they said they were gonna do? The next circle in are what I call advocates. These are people who are out in the world actively talking about how wonderful you are, how great your service or product. What I call allies. These are the 2 or 3 or 5 or 6, if you're lucky, people in your life who are invested. Always make the next move, knowing about acquaintances, associates, actors, advocates, and is a conversation that Hi. How are you? Not bad. How are you? Pretty good. What's new? Not much. What's new with you? Oh, same old thing. Been really busy, really tired. Well, great to see you. Well, we ought to get together sometime.
You've been listening.
Conversation in search of a topic. So instead, be prepared to be spontaneous. The question, how are you and what's new? For instance, tell about a resource that you found, a client you've helped, or a new enthusiast. And be ready to ask about things that you'd like to find or learn or connect with. When someone says, "What's new, Bill?" Articles for a variety of industry publications. So I often enjoy asking people what they like to read in their
someone says, "What's new?" or "How are you doing?" We're ready for something.
Exactly. You're ready.
Right. What about having a goal?
That's a great idea. Here's an example. You might say to yourself, I'm going to meet 5 new people tonight. Or you might say to yourself, I'm gonna be sure to reconnect with a friend. Or maybe I'm gonna ask Susan to introduce me to the program.
generally not a shy person. But if business events, I become shy. Help me and others learn how to get conversations started.
Well, again, be prepared with a few openers. Here's some examples. Might ask someone, what brings you to tonight's meeting? Or you might say, this is my first time here. Have you been a member long? Or you might tell someone, I came here hoping to meet other people who have home-based businesses. Is that why you're here? One more tip to Bill, make sure that your body language reflects your desire to meet people. All too often, I see people standing a vaguely bored look on their faces, eating another olive. Instead, smile and look confident. Go out of your way to greet people. Well, just last night I made a wonderful contact by introducing myself to someone in the hotel lobby who was obviously looking for the same networking meeting that I was.
Right, so you helped each other find me. Now in the introduction phase, I'm absolutely awful at remembering names. Any tips for me and the people listening?
Well, it's not so surprising that so many people say, I never can remember names. The next time you're at an event, Bill, count the number that people spend in the name exchange. What's your
can say.
No less than that. About 5 seconds. So the key here is to linger longer over the names. How can we learn each other's names in 5 seconds? Well, how do you linger longer? First of all, ask about the other person's name. Say, is that Linda with a Y or not? Or ask, do you like to be called William or Bill? And then be ready to teach them your name. Nothing fancy here, just a tip for remembering. I often say my name's Lynn with an E, and then years later that person will say to me, hi Lynn with an E. And one more thing, speak slowly and give your first name twice, so you'd say, hi, I'm Bill, Bill Hayes. Now, if you forget the name of someone you've met before, there are three things you can do. One is just go up to them and talk about what you talked about last time. Say, hi, how was your trip to New Mexico? Isn't it true that we often remember the topic, but we've forgotten their name? Another thing is just give your name. Say, hi, I'm Lynn. We talked here last time. They've probably forgotten your name too. Or a third thing you can do is ask somebody else to remind you of that person's name. Do that privately. Thank you.
to me being shy at these types of events, especially where everyone seems to know each other, except me. How do I join one of those clumps of people already engaged in conversation?
Well, one of the best networkers that I know tells me that she never joins those clumps. She just goes up to someone who's standing alone and makes her own clump. But if you do want to join a group, be ready with an opener. For instance, may I join you? If they all politely stop talking when you join. Or you could say, how do you all know each other? More likely is that the person who's talking when you enter that group will continue talking. So that's your cue to pace them. If they're smiling, you smile. If they're looking serious, you look serious. So you indicate with your eyes and your body language that you want to participate, not interrupt.
Good. I know that's going to help me. May I join you? When I heard you say that, I thought, yeah, I can say that. That'll work for me. Good. I know a lot of people seem to struggle when presented with the "what do you do?" question. When I'm asked this question, what should I say?
Well, first of all, avoid your job title. Avoid jargon that's rampant in every industry. Avoid an industry label such as "I'm in sales" or "I'm real estate." Instead, tell your talent Planet Hotel in 2 cents. One of your talents, and then a recent example of a project, a success. Instead of saying I'm a professional speaker or I'm a networking expert, I might say to people, I get people talking to each other at conventions. Last week I did a workshop for 300 people at the National Association of Home Builders. Now, if you do this, it will be easy for people to get into conversation with you, and you'll be giving them a vivid picture of your company.
Sounds good. What are good topics for me to bring up? What topics are more likely to lead to business exchanges?
Any topic that enthusiasm and energy for. It could be a personal interest, such as coaching your kid's soccer team, or it might be a business project, such as learning to use a new kind of software on your computer. And then listen for topics that the other person is interested in. No. Don't just listen generously, listen with an ear for how the resources and information that you have might help them succeed in business or with personal interests too.
Hey. And sometimes at events, I meet people who are super free with how they give out their business cards. I don't know if they're doing it because they think I might be a prospect for them, or if they're just trying to create name recognition, or maybe the printer printed 1,000 extra cards and they have them to give away. Talk to us about the role of business cards in a business.
Well, I learned about this at the beach recently when I went with a bunch of friends to the bumper cars. I remember playing bumper cars where you bang into each other.
I love them. I still love them.
Well, this was such a riveting experience for me, because I haven't done it since I was about 12, that it was on my mind, and when I came back to Washington, D.C., and went to a networking event, saw all these people bumping into each other and giving out 23 cards. It occurred to me that this was another game of bumper cars with business cards. Now, that is a cardboard connection, because you're going to get home with those cards. And I predict that you will put that little stack of cards on the edge of your desk, and it will start to talk to you, and it will say things like, "You haven't called me back. I bet you won't recognize me if you see me tomorrow. You better do something with me." And worse yet, all over town, there are stacks of cards on business, on desks, and your cards in that stack. And pretty soon, you know what happens? You just get busy. Push that stack off into the wastewater basin so it doesn't talk to you anymore. So instead of trying to give out 23 business cards, that's garbage. board. Instead, pour your energy into the conversation and look for a reason to exchange cards. A reason to extend the event beyond the event. A reason to call the person next Tuesday or fax them something in 2 weeks. I mean, wouldn't you rather go back to your office with the cards of 5 people that you know better than with the cards of 20 people who wouldn't remember you if they saw you next week?
Absolutely. If you have a good conversation with a person, what are the appropriate ways to reconnect with that person sometime later at that same event?
Well, that's a good question. How about bringing someone over to them and introducing them? See, always be looking for common interests so that you can be a great connector. Now, it might be for any reason. You might say to the people, you both have twins. You ought to meet each other. You both grew up in Chicago. You both work in the telecommunications field. And do say goodbye to the two or three people that you most want to become known to, because probably your conversation there was no more than 5 or 6 minutes long. So before you leave the event, go back to them. Reconfirm when you will call. Or just say, hey, great talking to you. I loved hearing about your new project.
That's a good idea. Saying goodbye leaves them leaving the event with the impression of you. Good. Are there usually people at most business events with whom you want to make sure you connect?
Well, Bill, on the one hand, I believe that everyone is a feature story. Everyone is deserving of our highest attention. On the other hand, there are centers of influence in every arena, in every industry, and good networkers figure out who these people are. The leaders in your trade association, the top sales reps in your industry or company? How about the people on the board of directors of a volunteer group that you're involved with?
Centers of influence. It's a good term for Lynn, there are several quizzes in your book so people can see how well they're networking people they already know. What are some of the questions in those quizzes?
Well, they're for people that you already know and also new people. For instance, ask yourself, did you meet 5 or 6 new people? Did you listen generously? Did you find something to give away? Did you extend the event beyond the event? For instance, did you meet somebody who works near you and you decide to have breakfast together? Did you get there early so you could help out or talk to the movers and shakers? Did you follow up with people promptly? Did you do what you said you would do? Did you volunteer in organization in a way that would either show off your talents or help you learn a new
about strategic networking as something that's more than just going to an event. It's building a relationship. That means we need to follow. How do I decide if I want to add a new contact to my network and then begin the follow-up process?
Well, I know that some experts they just work on building your relationships with the movers and shakers. But I say that everybody is important. For instance, what about your neighbor who is unemployed today, but could be the one who starts his own company tomorrow and places a $1 million order with you in 5 years.
So what you're saying that we stay in touch with everybody in some way or another? So, after I've met someone new, when should I follow up and what should I do to enhance relationships?
Well, remember that the highest form of networking is teaching and also trusting. So focus on reconnecting in ways that help you learn about them and in ways that teach them about you. For instance, what restaurant supply salesperson that I coached said to a desktop publisher that he met and liked, he said, well, how about giving me a short tour of your operation next week, and then when my company needs graphic arts, I can suggest you and really describe your services Here's another example. Mary remembered that Gloria mentioned the challenge of fitting exercise into her already too busy life. So Mary reconnected with a phone call, and she said she planned to walk on her lunch hour 3 times a week, and she'd love a partner.
Okay, so lots of different ways to follow up.
Yes.
Now, I like the example you gave me about this restaurant supply salesperson, because he wanted to go to that other person's place of business so he could learn more about it. So then when he had an opportunity to talk about it, talk more firsthand, and you could be more excited about this person who's referring good. So, people do business with and refer people whom they like and trust. In fact, in one of your books, you say it often takes 6 to 8 contacts with a person before they trust you enough to do business or refer business to you. How would anybody have time to create 6 to 8 conversations to get to that point?
It does sound amazing when you first hear about it, but be creative about making networking a way of life rather than one more thing to add to your to-do list. Are you going to a convention? Suggest that you and your contact take the same flight. Are you going to a Chamber of Commerce meeting? Call somebody up that you met there last week and offer to pick them up.
You know, you just made a good point in making it a way of life. I think what you're saying is that it's part of who you become. It's a mindset that you
yeah.
So it's not just a series of techniques to follow. This is how you're building your relationship, how you're building your business. Good. I've heard you say that not all conversations count. Follow-up. What do you mean by that?
If you're not learning something about the other person or teaching them something about you, it doesn't count as follow-up. It won't be memorable. Talking about the weather or the ball scores may fill up some time, but it rarely builds a business relationship.
Okay, so every contact has to count for something in terms of learning or teaching.
Yes.
Okay, in your book, 52 Ways to Reconnect, Follow Up, and Stay in Touch when you don't have time for networking, you offer some really great follow up.
Sure. Our 52 ways are coded according to how much time and money they take. And whether they'll put you in touch with one or few or many people. One that I like is to watch for ads in the newspaper, for instance, put out by your contact, the person you want to get to know better. Clip out that ad and mail it to them with a note about what you like about the ad. Or with an idea of what new market they might pitch their product or service to. Another idea is to choose 10 of the contacts that you want to get to know better and fax then the copy for a new brochure that you're working on and ask them for reactions.
So what you're saying here, another reason to contact someone could be asking them for a little bit of help.
Exactly. It builds the relationship. It teaches them about
you. Right. That's true.
A third idea is to set up a brown bag lunch or catered lunch with a local speaker and choose somebody you'd like to hear and then invite a few contacts. It might be somebody on marketing. It might be somebody who talks to you on how to cope with aging parents or teenage children. It doesn't have to be a business subject. Just a way for you to get back in contact with each other.
So it's a reason to get together.
Exactly.
In your book, you talk about trust busters and trust builders. Explain that, please.
Well, you and I don't sell products and services. We sell our competence and our character. And every interaction that we have with each other is either gonna build trust or bust trust. Competence means gearing your conversations to teach people about the excellent job you do, the awards you have, the way you continue to learn. Character means showing people moment by moment that you're fair and honest, that you're gonna make good on any mistakes, that you act with integrity in all your business dealings. So in every conversation that people have with you, they're assessing this. Now, this is not bragging. When you tell people about your character confidence. This is just learning to talk comfortably about your enthusiasms and successes.
Then you've given me, and I hope everyone listening, a lot of things to think about, and definitely some things to do. Do you have any final ideas or tips you'd like to leave with our listeners?
Yes, I do. One way to assess how you're doing and building a circle of contacts is to ask yourself once a week, who do I have to thank this week? And then reconnect with by thanking them. Thank the people who've contributed in any way at all to your success that week. Maybe they gave you support or information or resources or ideas or referrals, give them a call. Fax them a note. Send them flowers. Offer to help them in some way. Find a way to acknowledge their health. What a great way to spend Friday afternoon. If you've got at least 5 people to thank, give yourself a pat on the back. I truly believe that as our capacity for gratitude grows, our ability to give grows. And givers always make a great connection.
I can't thank Lynn Wayman enough for all the innovative ideas she's given. You'd like to truly master the art and skill of networking, then I highly recommend the 2 books by Lynn Wayman and her co-author Ann Baber. They are Great Connections, Small Talk and Networking for wonders that so beautiful. And now 52 ways to reconnect, follow up, and stay in touch when you don't have time. You can order these books right now, or when you get to a telephone, by calling 1-800-352-2939. 1-800-352-2939.
So now you have a growing network of people, some of whom may become clients, and most of whom will have the opportunity to refer business your way. I've given you ideas on how to build your network, and now it's Bill's turn to show you how to harvest your network for referrals that lead to more clients. Please join me in the next section of the tape as I interview the champion of referral selling, Bill Case.